welcome to the show, y'all.
Yeah, thanks for tuning in, y'all.
Elite.
Let's get it, let's get it.
And Uncle Ron. One false move and it's a checkmate. Ayy,
that's been a radio pundits and well.
Yeah. What up, though, y'all? This is your boy, Ernest J. Lee. You know what time it is. This is Unfiltered. It's another week, so that means it's another round. It's time to go higher. Look, we are so happy to be here each week with you, to give it to you straight with no chaser. We're trying to give it to you like God has given it to us. You know, everybody has an opinion, and that's fine, but I like to have facts. I like to have people that know what they're talking about. I like to have people on here that's going to come with it and bring that heat, baby. You know what I'm saying? That's how we do it, y'all. Now, as you know, for the last 3 weeks, we've been doing the Men Decoded series. Look, y'all, this has been epic. I know I keep saying that, but trust me, this has been great information. So many of you have reached out on direct message and text and let me know that you have been enjoying this series on men and what men like, what they don't like, where they've been, where they're going, what they deal with, the people they deal with, the struggles they deal with, the bull crap they deal with. Listen, Men Decoded, everything you always wanted to know about a man, we've been talking about for the last 3 weeks. And this week is no different. This is going to be the recap show today, and I'm not going to waste a lot of time. I'm going to get right to it. But please do this for me right now. Stop and go search Ernest J. Lee Unfiltered so you can be connected to our podcast. They're free, y'all. Ernest J. Lee Unfiltered. If you search the name, you'll be instantly connected just like that. Spreaker.com, Spotify, Apple Music, Google Play, all of them. Just search it, y'all, and you'll be blessed. Like Uncle Ron said, you'll be blessed. Listen, also do this for me. Please share this broadcast right now. Let someone know that Unfiltered is on the air. Let someone know that Men Decoded Part 3 is getting ready to go down. My panel is here. We're ready to jump in. We're ready to show up and show out. Yo, it's about to be a wave up in this mug, a wave of glory, Doc. Lift your old dirty hands and tell him thank you. No, but for real, y'all, get ready because we're about to go in. Don't keep this information to yourself. People need this. So go on and let someone know that we're on right now, y'all. I'm telling you, share it because they're going to need it. Men everywhere. Women everywhere. Ladies need to know what men like, too. I know I got that right. So go on and tap your neighbor and say, neighbor, he got that right. But look, let me get to some of this music. I'm going to go on and throw it back to my boy, Kirk Carr. This is an oldie but goodie right here, y'all. He's really, really, really been good to me, you, and everybody. Put your hands together right here. And keep it locked on Unfiltered with Ernest J. Lee and Uncle Ron.
Yeah.
Unfiltered with Ernest J. Lee and Uncle Ron.
We the radio pundits and we're unfiltered.
Hey, y'all, what's going on? It's your boy, Ernest J. Lee, and we're live and in living color on Unfiltered with Ernest J. Lee and Uncle Ron. Guess what, y'all? This is part three of the series that we're doing on men called Men Decoded. Look, due to the overwhelming response that we had over the last few weeks, I was originally going to do two parts, but y'all know sometimes you got to just go with the spirit, and this third part came up. And look, we're back again today. I got my crew with me today. We're getting ready to go back in. Listen, hold on to your seats. We got some stuff to talk about today, some stuff that we really didn't hit over the last two parts, and I really wanted to clean up today because this information is needed. It's information that you can't get anywhere else because people don't really want to talk about the truth. They want to talk around the truth, and they want to talk about stuff that sounds good and make you feel good. But sometimes you got to hear the hard truth, the hard facts, and that's what we're going to do on Unfiltered today. So look, I got my two people with me today. I got Leon Crawford. What's up, boy?
Hey, what up, Doe, from Detroit. That's what we say. What up, Doe? And for all my saints, hey, praise the Lord, grace and peace.
You know what, dog? I'll be finding out when I'm down here in Atlanta walking the street because there's so many implants down here. Like, if they see me with a Detroit thing on, man, they look over, I don't care where they at, and they be like, what up, though? I'll be like, what up, though? That's a Detroit thing, man. People don't know about that, Leon. I'm telling you. And you already know I got my main man, the doctor's in the house, Dr. William Byron Reese. Man, what's going on, man?
Well, I'm saved. I'm from the suburbs.
You know what?
Hallelujah.
Okay. All right. Praise the Lord, brother.
All right.
Yeah, right. Hey, his church get out at noon, Leon. They start at 11:30 and get out at noon, Doc.
I can't talk. I get out at 11:30.
Well, Doc, I get out at 3. I'm from the day of Pentecost.
You know what? See, this is what I'm talking about. This is how it's supposed to be when men get together. It's supposed to be just, look, let's just talk like we kick it. We ain't got to put on no airs. We ain't got to act like we don't talk like this. This is how men talk. And that's what we're doing today. Men Decoded. So look, guys, let's jump right in today. I don't want to waste no time. So look, we left off last week. We were talking about a whole lot of things, man. But this week, I want to pick up on something. We talked about marriage stats and, you know, why people are not getting married. But I want to go a little deeper than that this week. So, Leon, you up first, man. Look, now we know that this show goes through a whole lot of different races and creeds and stuff like that. But this week, I want to center in on our sisters, man, because we got a lot of sisters that we know, man, in this church world, in the world, period. And we got to help them out, man. So let's deal with them today. As it relates to marriage, why does it seem like it's hitting the black woman so hard, man? What is the stats on that? What do they tell us?
Well, if you want to deal with spiritual matters versus natural matters, first of all, I want to deal with Christian women. Christian black women. They have been sold a bill of goods that is not realistic. It is inspirational. In other words, you go to church, sister go to church, she receive a prophecy. The prophet says, wedding bells, blah, blah, blah. I hear the Lord saying, you'll be married, blah, blah. You know, she fall out in the flow screaming, yeah, I knew this was my year, whatever. But the statistics in the natural does not line up with a lot of some of the inspiration that sisters receive in church. In other words, you can have inspiration. That's wonderful, but it's very key that you have information as well.
Wow.
And when it comes to information, you deal with black men. 35% of black men have a high school diploma. 35% high school diploma.
Wow.
That's mind-boggling to me. When a sister's believing God and praying that my man's going to have a degree. Well, let's go to degree. Black men that have a degree is 17% graduate with a bachelor's degree. 17%. Well, my man is, everybody don't got to go to school and be educated. What about the brothers with money? Okay, so now you're believing God for a baller. 26% of black men live below the poverty line. 11% unemployed. Now, these numbers are years ago, and I understand that since Obama and Trump have addressed the unemployment, jobs have been created. And so I'll give you some slack in that area. Mm-hmm. But watch this, Doc. 67% of black men that get up and hump work every day make $37,000 a year. $37,000 a year. Meanwhile, black women in churches believe in God for a baller, believe in God for someone that's an executive, someone that, you know, got it all going on, making six or seven figures. Well, the numbers are not there. Now, that does not mean that they cannot be there and it cannot happen, because with God, all things are possible. But I think sisters need to shift their prayer language and stop saying, Lord, send me a Boaz, which is the worst prayer a woman could pray, because Boaz had sex the night they got married and he died. But
wow.
So they should never pray that. But really begin to pray for men genuinely, not just for a husband, but for our black men. They need prayer and hands-on assistance.
Yes.
We need sisters that are helping brother with his business that he's trying to get started. You can't come in when everything is already built and thinking, you know, all of a sudden you're going to sit down and be the queen of the kingdom that he's built. We right. need sisters to pray and work together. Introduce that brother to a school. Introduce that brother to a grant that can pay for the school. Introduce that brother, you know, to various ways to get our men to the plateau to where God has called us to. Other than that, you're going to keep going to Friday night service, throwing $100, spinning around with oil all over you, falling out, getting back up, going back home.
Right. And think about this, man. This is the message that they hear every week, because you know why? It's always another conference. It's always a women's conference. And I'm not knocking none of it. I'm saying, what are we actually teaching them there? Because we're teaching them, especially in church, you know, pray and God has it and keep yourself to yourself. And, you know, God is going to send you who you need. Listen, if you're not prepared, that's almost like telling somebody one day you're going to wake up rich. If you don't know how to manage your money, you're going to make a shipwreck. So sometimes women just, they have the wrong information. You know, like you just said, they don't even have the school on their own track record. They don't even have learning how to manage their money on their own. They haven't been taught that stuff, man. So, you know, what is your advice to that?
Let me say this. When you think about women today, all women, black, white, whatever, American women, at the end of the day, they chasing the bag, Doc. It's about that bag. Look at this. 67% of black men only make $37,000. And then you want to live in this house, you want to drive this car, you want this fur, you want these diamonds, you want all that. The numbers are not there. So what is going on is we have frustration, and it's coming from church. This is stuff that's coming from church. And so when you deal with that, first of all, we got to get you lined up to pray the right type of man to help
right.
out, to
there
build up. So then you will learn how to handle your finances. Because
that's what
if
I'm
you
saying.
Understand that the man is only going to make less than $40,000 a year, but you want to live a certain lifestyle, you're going to have to put in yourself. So you got to be good with QuickBooks. You got to be good with budgeting as well. Because at the end of the day, y'all going to end up throwing pots and pans and slamming doors because there ain't no money there. But you should have knew that when you got married or when you started pursuing a relationship.
So true. Now, Dr. Reese, right there, I want to hit this right here. Now, a lot of people may not understand what we're about to say right here, but I want you, the doctor, so you're going to bring it out for us. Because we've heard about soul ties, but we've only heard about soul ties as relates to physical connections and having relations with people. But let's bring that into our black sisters right now. Some of them have girlfriends and people that they talk to and their moms in some cases. They influence them to have some of this behavior. So let's talk about unhealthy soul ties amongst people's friends, man. Let's hit that.
Soul ties. It's intertwined with the field of psychology. Mm-hmm. Psychology literally means, in the Greek, psuche, soul. It's studying a person's soul, their way of being in the world, which is integrated or synonymous with biblical terms, heart, mind, soul, spirit. Throughout the Old and New Testament, those terms are intertwined. Mm-hmm. So when you begin to talk about making soul ties with another person, there are variations of those soul ties. You mentioned the physical aspect of it, and then there's the spiritual aspect of it. But in my humble opine, I would say when you talk about integration, all that becomes one, where we don't see that significant line of demarcation, because sometimes people will even separate sexuality. You know, even in marriage, sex is filthy, right?
Mm-hmm.
Can't keep nobody in marriage just for sex. What, just with sex? Is that what that is in a marriage? You know, like it's, you know, we do the do and then now we're back up. You know, that's not what the biblical marriage is about. You know, it still has that negative connotation.
Now, right.
I'm big on soul ties because we all have soul ties with other human beings. We
right.
were created to have fluidity, to be in communication, in communion, is a better word, one to the other, okay? Mm-hmm. So when we have that communication, we become powerful. People don't complete us, they don't crown us, but communion is just so powerful. And both men have it with other men, mm-hmm. And women have it with other women, okay? With men, ours is sometimes just as emotional, you know, with our brothers, you know, our blood brothers, our best friends, whatever, that's a given. But then in the multitude of men, we tend to have that same power or emotional bond, but we somewhat, you know, we work it out differently. We'll be competitive and we'll laugh it off with humor, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We don't go to the mall and walk into the dressing room together and say, man, how do these jeans look on my behind? You know, we mm-hmm. don't do that kind of stuff, right? But
right.
the women will do it all day and laugh. Oh, yeah, you know, they have that freedom, you know. Now, if it's my son or my blood brother, man, take that mess off, right? But still, mm-hmm. women enjoy many more emotional freedoms, both publicly mm-hmm. and privately, that we as men do not have, especially when it comes to influence in the household,
mm-hmm.
you know, that motherly influence or that girlfriend influence. They tend to be far more provocative, far more revealing in the information that they give to their same-sex peers, if you will, or comrades. And
yes.
that gives people maybe an inroad into your marriage, into your relationships, that oftentimes, unless there's abuse like that, can become invasive, most mm-hmm. invasive. And it can carry at times a spirit that comes with it. I'm not trying to go down no Oogaboogaboo road or no Warfare road, but I was telling someone early in the week, it can be likened unto witchcraft.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Well, maybe that person's husband is having promiscuity problems or affair problems. She tells your wife about it. Your wife comes back, you know, looking at you cockeyed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, her whole world, you know, not only has her husband is having an affair, but possibly you're having an affair and you're not even known for that. That's the furthest thing from your mind. But there's that one eye that's open on you now because that girlfriend has been given unparalleled access to your home by way of her girlfriend's woundedness, her girlfriend's bitterness, or even her girlfriend's jealousy that you are the man that, you know, her girlfriend has and she doesn't have that. So those are unhealthy soul ties, and a lot of people are having these emotional affairs, these soulish affairs with people outside of their marriage, if you will, and they're doing everything with them but having sex.
Mm.
Now, I know that sounds strange and weird, but the only difference in some of these relationships are is just that they're not having sex. So my thing is, marry your mama.
Yeah, right.
Stay home. Sure. Marry right. your daddy. Mm-hmm. You know, marry the first lady. Like in my even pastoral experience, you know, all these ladies at my first church, they're running to this lady, one of the mothers of the church, giving all this advice. Mother so-and-so ain't seen a man in 50 years, and when she had one, she couldn't even keep him.
Mm-hmm.
So how is she the showpiece of maritalhood? She's still giving advice out of her woundedness. God bless her with love and peace. I get it. And then all the women that she's counseled, none of them, they never keep a man.
Right.
You know, so again, we have to be careful. There's nothing wrong with sound advice, but I always say go get professional advice.
Yes.
Just like Caucasians do. Pay them to keep your mouth shut.
Yeah, you're right.
$15 copay, and I will tell you all about my troubles. Just a little talk with the psychologist
makes it all right. You know what? See, this is why you got to have people that's professional on your show, because this is some perspective that we won't get listening to somebody preaching. I'm not against preachers. I love preachers. But this kind of stuff, what he just said, is so true. We got to have professional counseling sometime, not just somebody that's been through something, but somebody that's trained to deal with what you are dealing with. Listen, this discussion is heating up. We're going in. It's Men Decoded Part 3, y'all. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back with more right after this. Don't y'all go nowhere. We'll be right back.
Hey, this is Uncle Ron, one half of the new show Unfiltered. Listen, do you want to advertise or even be featured on one of our shows? Make sure you reach out to us and let us know. Email us at theunfilteredradioshow@gmail.com. Also, if you have any show topics and or questions that you would like for us to tackle, please feel free to let us know. We would love to hear from you. Make sure you keep it locked right here. I'll holla.
We're keeping it 100. Unfiltered. We're the radio pundits and we're unfiltered.
What up, y'all? This is E. Lee. We're back live right here. Men Decoded Part 3. I got my panel, Dr. Crawford, Dr. Byron Reese. Man, we're here. We're going in. Let's get back into it. Dr. Reese, before we left, we were talking about just a little talk with the psychologist makes it all right. And I believe that. That's some good stuff right there. So I'm going to pick it back up with you, man. Listen, in the home, though, sometimes, you know, you had mentioned a few weeks ago on part one that sometimes men are scared to speak out about stuff that they don't like and stuff that they see that's wrong. How can we balance that out? You know, it's a lot of passive aggressiveness in the home.
Well, that man must decide what his marital and family methodology is. Okay.
Okay.
He must decide. He must demand it. He must make his wife aware of it when going into the marriage. And if it changes, he must make his wife aware of it as the marriage evolves. It's different modalities. There's nothing wrong with it. Whatever works for that couple. But what I find in my experience in counseling and psychotherapy and research with men and masculinities is that so many of these men are, I won't say afraid to speak up, but if they speak up, they rock the boat.
Mm-hmm.
It causes disharmony in the home. And most men don't like that long-term disharmony. You know, the non-speaking as a weapon, the abatement of chores and duties and roles in the household. They don't like that. But they like the peace of the home or even the going back and forth. A lot of men, you know, do sort of like the back and forth, but then some just really don't. They don't like a whole lot of mouth. I know that sounds sexist. That's a triggering word for women. Well, what do you mean by that? Most men don't like all that. And then when the men begin to turn the tables, you know, and push back with the silent treatment, you know, they're shocked. So I always advise men, learn how to articulate your story. Articulate your experience. Write it down. If you can't vocalize it, this is what I like this day. Write a letter. I do not want to go to this place. They are not allowed in my home. You know, make those rules up. Ladies tend to make it known what they don't like, you know, one way or the other. And just put it out there. You know, even if it has to be brazen, at least you placed in the atmosphere, especially if you have children. Your children need to see that type of headship. And I said headship. They need to see that type of headship and that husbandry and that fatherhood in the home.
Yes.
They don't get to see a passive male letting anyone run all over him, regardless of his communication style. I had to probably say that from the get-go. He needs to make it known. Say it. Vocalize it. Claim your authority. And that takes nothing away from your wife, from the mother of the home.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Happy wife, happy life. No, we're not doing that. We're not catering to anyone, you know. And that's a simp, because if you have a lot of simps coming out there now, and a lot of these newer young men, they're starting to say, you know, if I could just work and all that kind of stuff. The man is not just a provider. He's more than a provider. He doesn't exist to provide and protect. True enough, that's a part of his biology, if you will. As a part of his instinct, my research from my master's clinical thesis talks about that in this book called Sperm Wars. Men, we have that instinctually. We're territorial. You know, women say, well, I can tell, you know, she like you. A gentleman can tell when a man is flirting with his wife. You know, you can't put nothing by me. I have eyes. I can tell when a man is trying to come for my daughter and my sons. It's that intuition that men naturally have. okay? So again, he should not be dumbed down in this household to make him think he's some, you know, belligerent idiot or a chauvinist. That becomes a weapon. And if a young lady has not seen that example in the place of her birth, the place of her nativity, she's not having it. She's not having it. And she will just wield her greatest weapon against you, even that marriage.
Yes. Now, Dr. Crawford, let's pick up right there. I'm going to switch it a little bit. Now, I've heard a lot of people say as we get older, we put it a lot of different ways, but I'm going to say it like this. As men get older, especially after 40, we really don't want a hard time. Dr. Reese alluded to it earlier. We really don't want a hard time, especially at home, because that's supposed to be a place of peace, a place of our rest, you know, our sanctuary, if you will. So, and I know this could be a broad statement, but why do you think that so many of us are switching races as it relates to our spouse choice, you know, so, or our girlfriend choice? You know, a lot of people don't like to deal with the same race, especially us blacks. You know, what do you say about that, man? Let's go on and go in on it, bro.
Ooh-wee. Okay, first thing we need to know is men want respect.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, when mama or daddy dropped us off at school, that was the first time out of the house. We began to engage with other little boys, and we found out that there's a little boy that's a little tougher, a little rougher, or whatever. At some point, you got to learn how to gain your respect. And so from that day, when he walks out of that house, whether it's a bully or whether it's someone doing something wrong to him, he's got to learn to speak up, fight, or do whatever he has to do to gain respect. Now, when it comes to relationships, when a man wants a wife or a mate, the first thing he's going to know, want to know, as a long-term relationship, to keep the fire burning, is how well this woman will respect me. And let me say this. Women, if you are listening, you have to be creative in birthing respect towards your husband. In other words, you may be the smartest one or the one at this time making the most money, and there's a deal. When the person pushed the deal across the table for the papers to be signed, he may push it towards the woman or look toward the woman in a meeting, or the wife rather. The wife has got to know how to be so creative and push those papers right to her husband and say, honey, let him know how we feel. In other words, you have to be more creative with respect when it comes to even in your home, how to respect your mate, your husband, in such a way that every man wants to feel like a king in his castle.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm saying all that to say this, to lean towards the ethnos or the ethnic groups that automatically teach their women either verbally, sit-down talks, or flat out by an example, how to give respect to that man. A lot of mouth, a lot of what I call smack and roll. You're smacking your lips and rolling your eyes to the suggestion or the voice of the man is going to cause his respect level to feel damaged and feel like, well, if I'm not getting respect here, I'm going to get me some respect somewhere. Two things that men are going to want is real men. They're going to want respect and they're going to want sex. So, when we go to ethnic groups and other ethnic groups, these things are kind of already laid, a foundation has been laid. Meanwhile, in our community, as black people, most women have been raised by their best friend. And their best friend telling them, girl, I wouldn't do this. Girl, I wouldn't do that. And so here, the woman can lay out two dresses. Honey, which one you like, the yellow one or the blue one? And he said, baby, I love that blue dress on you. She will go to her friend and ask her, girl, what you think I should wear, this yellow one or the blue one? And her friend would say, girl, you know that yellow one is the bomb. You gonna kill him with that yellow one on. She would lean towards the wearing the yellow dress more than the blue dress. That's disrespect.
Yes.
And And that's just little simple things, but you have to peel the layers of this onion back and understand. And women need to pray, say, Lord, give me an eye to understand how to respect, how to honor, and show that towards my husband, because that's the main thing that a man is going to want. And so if other ethnic groups are doing it, our sisters going to have to come up in that area. Now, I don't want to sound like I'm bashing sisters or beating them down. And I've had this conversation before with women, with black women, and guess what they said? Oh, I'm not going to dummy myself down for him.
Wow.
So in other words, these women are so headstrong that they don't even know how to honor. They don't know how to be submissive. Mm-hmm. And then you add on their friends raising them, who, as Doc said, or the church mother raising them, and they ain't had a man in 20 years.
Right. And the game done changed.
And the game, Doc, the game done changed, Doc.
Hey,
sister, please hear me. The game done changed. It ain't about a way to a man's heart into his stomach. No, you got to go a little lower than that.
Right. Watch it. Now, listen, before we go to break, Dr. Reese, cap this same conversation. Just briefly cap this right quick before we go to break. Now, why do you feel that so many men are leaning toward other ethnic groups?
Oh, because they choose to.
Okay.
I love who I want to love. It's not a company decision. Mm-hmm. It's not a corporate decision. It's that man's choosing. And me, he must have the guts to honor that. It has nothing to do with black, white, or if I marry outside my race. Mm. It's genetic suicide. No, it's who I choose to. It's my decision. And if you have kids, of course, they may play a role in it, second and third marriages or whatever. But still, you honor that choice. And that, to me, is the beauty of God. You know, that's the beauty of sexuality or heterosexuality, if you will, is that you have choice more than just race. Mm. Or I was speaking with Dr. Crawford and you before we came on. The fact of the matter is your social circle, you know, what comes up in your social circle, what comes up for you at work, what comes up for you at church. Most of us met our spouses at church. So it means we were not just at church reading Sunday school books and shouting and dancing. We're always sensually and sexually aware, because that is a crucial part of our being. It lies at the core of our being. So that's the power of our choice. It takes nothing away from beautiful black women. But our battle cry should not be love me or marry me because I'm black.
Yeah.
It's, you know, that just, it goes into like a needy type thing, mm-hmm. you know, and now we're picking apart all these black male superstars. Look at him. He's no good. He's bailing out. What? You know, no, he was just at a party having a good time. You know, he got a number. He likes her. He loves her. He's in love with her. You know, and his mother, look at his mother, he hates himself. No, I mean, what kind of scientific foolishness and theology is that? And at the end of the day, you're not in my home. You're right. Not in my bedroom. And at the end of the day, you don't know what makes an individual happy.
Reese, I love it, man. This is some good stuff right here, y'all. I'm telling you, we need this information. This is some real stuff. People pay good money for this stuff. So we're going to take a break right here, man. I'm loving the flow. I hate to break it up. We've got to take a break and get to some music. And we'll be right back with more Unfiltered right after this, y'all. Keep it locked. It's a throwback again, y'all. Y'all know Dawkins and Dawkins with the homeboy from Detroit, J. Moss. Child of God. That's what we are, man. Let's stand strong.
Don't slip, and you better be bout it. When the trumpet sound this, you might be grounded. Come on.
Concerns me when you do what you wanna do, ignoring the voice of the Father. Oh, it's time for you to jump on the wagon. Stop all your slacking, 'cause you're a child of God and He loves you. Oh.
You're a child of God, no matter who you are, the man you are, climb the ladder to the stars. Child of God.
day that you don't control.
So you don't know
what entails the future.
Oh, oh, in the rain, there's no need to hate.
Jam has no time for show, go for what we know. But why you worried about us, thinking that we caught up? But you're right, he's like a magnet, he's filling us up. Now put your mind to work, cause if we grind the dirt without the Lord, meet the fireworks. I ain't talking about July the 4th, we've been shaking hands with the fool Lucifer.
Tell the God, tell the God, who you are.
Back live right here on Unfiltered with Ernest, J. Lee, and Uncle Ron. I know you enjoying this show today. Part three, Men Decoded, Dr. Reese, Dr. Crawford. We're going in. Look, Dr. Crawford, since my brother, Pastor Ginaldo Lee, is not on with us tonight, you got to handle the spiritual stuff for us, bro. Now, listen, I know I'm about to get in trouble for this, but I don't care. This is Unfiltered, so this is what we're going to do. But I'm going to ask you a question, Doc, and I'm going to just keep it real. What's your opinion about, do we really need a partner in ministry? You know, because so many people, when they get pastor, they get bishop, they automatically make their wife the co-pastor or the co-this and the co-that. Is that necessary now? Or, I mean, what's your take on that?
If we look biblically and we look at the church, there were no first ladies or co-pastors, and them brothers was going hard for Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
But we're living in a different day. Yes, we need a partner, but again, it's concerning your vision. Here's the biggest thing that I think we don't need. We don't need a partner to cover areas that we feel like we will fall in trap. So you have brothers who have a call on their life, have ministry, but they need sex to stay saved and be able to keep their ministry so they get married to somebody. So we don't need that. But what we do need, we need good partners that know their role and are willing to accept that. Every first lady doesn't have to sing, wear a big hat, or preach. The vision and the mandate or the call that's on a man's life should dictate or cause him to have a checkup from the neck up, is what I like to say, and do what makes sense for him. I know some beautiful brothers is out there pastoring without a wife, and they're doing well. And then I know some brothers that single and got married, and their wives chased everyone away from the church.
Thanks.
So, and I think that the main thing is that you find someone compatible. Don't get a woman for your church vision, but get a woman for a kingdom vision that will help out. But no, you don't need a white co-pastor and, you know, all of that. But at the end of the day, we know you're going to need a woman at some point if you're a real man.
Right. I agree with that. And I asked that question because I've heard some bishops and pastors and people say, you know, how are you going to be a pastor if you're not married? Which I think is kind of whack to even say. I mean, that, like you just said, there's a lot of people in the Bible weren't married. You know what I'm saying? So, I don't, you know, I just don't understand that. You know, I think that's kind of that old school church teaching.
Well, let me say this. That kind of thinking comes from a misogynistic mindset. See, the old school thought that if you didn't get married, you're going to start having sex with the women in the church. So they wanted you to hurry up and get married as a minister. A minister needs a wife. Well, mm-hmm. what they were saying was a minister needs a bedmate.
Mm.
They felt like that was going to keep them. But brothers is married and love the Lord and preaching hard and still end up in the wrong bed at times. But if you do get married or if you are married and a minister, make sure you have a kingdom mandate and the wife knows the role. Because what happens is a lot of times these women, if they have giftings on their life, they can sing good. Next thing you know, they call a preach. Next thing you know, they call a prophesy. And now you battling for time whether you're going to prophesy and preach or your wife going to prophesy and preach, you know. And you can see some ministries where sometimes the wife can out-preach the pastor. Out prophesy the pastor, out pray the pastor. Then there's jealousy and, you know, all of that. But if you keep it kingdom, then you'll know her role, his role, and all of that. But just don't do it just because of that old school thinking that a minister needs to be married so he can make sure he don't have sex with the wrong people.
I totally get it. Now, see, this leads me to my next point, Dr. Reese. I've seen you post about this, and I want you to bring this out for my audience. We quote the scripture, and so many people quote it, and it's the woman's favorite scripture. They love to quote this one. He that findeth a wife findeth a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. Give us the real definition of that scripture, because I think people got it wrong. It's not that they got it wrong by definition. It's just the interpretation of the scripture I think is wrong. Go ahead.
They interpret it like a Disney movie, like a damsel in distress. First of all, it's from wisdom literature. Wisdom literature, it's not outright authoritative, you know. Same category with the other one we quote, that we our top two black folk scriptures, you know. Proverbs 31 woman, then he that finds a wife, and then the third one, spare the rod, spoil the child, you know. That's all wisdom literature. It's not authoritative. In other words, thus said the Lord God, you know. The backdrop for that finding a wife, that's courtship. That man that finds a wife, that is quote unquote finds a good thing, that good thing is a virgin.
Wow.
A woman that is untouched. Okay. You know, so you have single women that rightfully so have been previously touched out there, and you know, they've had sex already. They've had children. They've been probably married before. They're probably in their 30s, you know, in their 40s and 50s, and they're still looking. Oh, great. He's still pursuing. And they're marketing themselves, you know, I'm not going to meet somebody. I'm not chasing no man and that particular jargon. But that scripture is out of context. That's not talking for those of us who, both men and women, who are no longer virgins. But again, and realistically, most people who are adults, if you will, for the most part, even in the church, are sexually active. So let's cut to the chase. Let's stop pretending, you know, hiding behind God with these pseudo interpretations of the sacred text, whether it be wisdom, prophecy, law, history, whatever it is. Let's interpret it properly and put it in its context. Because, you know, we hide out with all this pseudo God stuff. Especially black folks out of the Pauline epistles. Paul said, well, who is Paul? Right? You know?
Right.
Paul says, you know, a man shouldn't wear long hair, so I'm going to cut my dreadlocks off, my locks off, because Paul said so, you know?
Right.
You know, all this stuff that we take out of context, and we've got to really get back into the Word. What does the Word say about this? What does the Word say about my marriage? And it can be very dangerous, because even in ministry, you know, your ministry is both vocation and career.
Right.
So you got to have the wisdom to know the difference. These ladies don't give you all that crap if you're a doctor. They're going to make rounds with you, you know, on the floors, trying to figure out if you're talking to the ladies on the floor, they don't go to the plant with you, right? We don't go to the plant with our spouses. You know, the first lady at GM. Who's the first lady at GM? You know, right. No, they wise. Christ, you know, so that we can make more out of ministry, more out of a church than it really is.
Man, that's good stuff right there, man. Wow.
That's the enemy that sets up that dumb stuff in churches, you know, where that pastor's marriage has to be the ideal marriage in the church. No, that's Deacon Tony and Tanya over there. You know, let them be over the marriage ministry. They're
right.
More qualified. And just because you've been married 60 years does not mean that's a successful marriage. That can mean tolerance. And the black church gets so carried away with that foolishness. And we've done it to ourselves. Look at all our photos. They go here on the Hattie, First Lady of Mississippi Milwaukee Tabernacle. You know, no longer do we see photos of the cross and church symbols. It's all about marketing the family. And that's because of the insufficiency of the black family. So instead of marketing the kerygma, we're marketing the family structure.
Now, look, fellas, before we run out of time today, I want to hit a few topics quickly. I'm going to throw out something. I want you guys to just throw it back at me, primarily in the black church, since that's what we're dealing with today. I've seen where a lot of people, men, they don't want to work a regular job. They would rather say God called them the pastor. What do you say about that, Dr. Crawford?
Oh, let me tell you something. Oh, my God. I have seen this stupidity. I was raised by real men. And let me be honest with you guys. Most of the real men that raised me didn't go to church, but they went to work. Now, I'm not saying you have to have a 9-to-5, but you got to bring something to the table if you want to eat.
Right.
These guys that's out here with their wives, bringing in money, going to work, and they are not working, and their ministries are struggling, man, you're worse than an infidel. Okay, I'm gonna just break it down. You a pimp. That's what's going on. You pimping. You popcorn what? Pimping in the name of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
I do know people who got like 3 members, 4 or 5 members, won't get a job, wife go to work every day. That's not God, man. I mean, you know what? If we take God out of the equation in church and all that, that ain't even what a guy is supposed to be like. You gotta want to have your own. I don't care if you sell socks on the corner, collect pop bottles, do whatever you gotta do to bring in money. One thing I've always tried to pride myself about, even when I did not work, I've had ministry to pay me where I did not have to work a 9-to-5.
Mm-hmm.
But one thing I've always prided myself was to take that money and make more money with it, myself, investments and stuff like that, and to be the number one tither of my own ministry. So I'm going to leave it at that.
I love it. See, again, this is the kind of stuff that people don't like to say because they think it's stepping on people's toes. But we got to step on toes if we want the truth. Now, Dr. Reese, I'm going to ask you a different question now, real quick. What are your thoughts about spiritual fathers? That's going crazy in the church right now. You know, everybody's a spiritual son. Everybody got a spiritual father. And these spiritual fathers are making them sow and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, they feel like they have to keep up with this to be accepted into the fold. Man, what's going on with the spiritual father thing right quick?
I think men are developing, are seeking to build legacies outside of their natural legacy. We're too lazy to develop our own natural legacy within our own families. So at times we expand that, not authentically, but to expand our power, to expand our privilege, and to expand our profits.
Wow.
Well, persons like me, I naturally mentor. I naturally have many sons. We were just laughing earlier from my first pastor and all the young ladies and men that are graduating from college, Wayne State, U of M. You know, that's my heritage at Prayer Tabernacle for the 18 years that I pastored there. It wasn't albums and Voice of Tabernacles and choirs and musicians and all that. It was young men and young women, you know, looking at that education piece that myself and my family planted in that ministry, and they got it. Not being negative, preachers that want to not so much emulate our lives,
but the engagements, you know, if you become my son, I can get you engagements, I can get you a church, I can make you an adjutant, I can make you a overseer, and eventually I can make you a bishop like me. So it's that matriculation that they're after. It's that power structure that they're after, not necessarily gaining someone's spirit, which to me, that is wonderful. That's what I'm about, while having your own way of doing things. So it's about power, really. And it's not fair to these innocent persons that we're doing that to, because they can't afford it.
Right.
They're broke. Dr. Crawford just told us, you know, they're not exempt. These young men in ministry are working jobs too. $37,000 a year, you know? Yeah. And they're trying to play that Louis Vuitton, BMW, nice house, nice wife, quote unquote, game as well. And they can't afford it. So naturally they can't afford to bring you $1,000 for your pastor's anniversary, $1,000 for your church anniversary. And then when the convention meet up, got to pay $1,000 for the archbishop, $1,000 for the archbishop's wife, and then she's having the birthday, then she's having the anniversary. It's too much. And that, if we're honest, we only do that in some of our black denominations. In the AME church, the largest Methodist, they don't do that. And the United Methodist Church, which is predominantly white, but there are some blacks in it. If I'm a bishop and I go to, they preach in my church, my pastor St. Paul, they are not allowed an offering. The superintendent is not allowed an offering when they come and visit. They're only doing their duty. They've already been compensated. They already have a pre-honorarium from their contract, from the actual district, the actual headquarters. They're not coming asking a 100-member church with a 35,000 square foot building that the roof is falling in to give them $1,000. So again, the dynamics are different. So we've created, and I guess I sound so negative, we've created plantations on the backs of the black, and I'm quote unquote uneducated, which is not reflective, poor.
Yep.
And we know we are. We're aware of
and
that.
Let me interject this right here. That's the problem I have with it. See, this is the thing. Every pastor knows their congregation. You know, if you know that the people in your congregation are not doing well financially, why do you keep making them give like that? That is, I don't get that, man. I just don't understand it.
Well, because it's opportunity. Because in fairness to some, they have different programs, you know, wealth management and credit and expungement and opportunities. That's well and good. I've had that. But when you don't have those resources, at the end of the day, you should not be challenging people to asking people to give their bill money. I've been there. You go to these conventions trying to be blessed, you know, and take some of the courses. I've been to some of those full gospel conventions. Well, I had. My family had it. My goodness, they're asking for your lunch money. You ever been to a convention? I mean, you only go with some, you got to eat three times a day, and then they're constantly bombarding you. You know, it becomes too much. And then it's a matter of even sometimes shaming you because you don't have it. The constant shaming. I've sat in those places and I'm like, wow, well, you've given everything except for your underwear. There's nothing else left to give.
And you know what, Dr. Crawford, take us on out of here with this, but let me just say this before you take us out. This is the reason why I say that. Because, look, you know these people are struggling to even make ends meet. Why do you keep challenging them to have faith in something that you know ain't going to be there? You see, people take a great biblical principle that works, because giving works. I'm not even talking about that. We know that. You reap what you sow. But why take a principle that you know that works and make it a whole theology, if you will?
Well, most of it is like paying a bill without understanding what the charges are. You never look at what you're being charged for. The company is going to continue to bill you and then go up. But once you finally open the receipt and say, what are you charging me for? And then you can contest the bill. Well, when you put God's said on it and finances with hope and dreams attached to it to people, they become goofy and refuse to check the bill.
Wow.
And then on top of that, we serve a prosperous God, and we should prosper. We should be blessed. But a lot of times, pastors are looking at a model of what they've seen somebody else do, and they're copying that, and then they just going to wear people out with it.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? So they're going to roll in the profits because the congregation ain't really tithing properly. Somewhere between 17 to 30% of the people tithe. The rest are just giving whatever. But I've seen when the prophet came, people had all kind of money.
Right, because they want that word, Doc.
They want that word. So when you add money into it, you know you basically turn it into soothsaying. But, okay, that's another day. Doc, I had prophets call me and say, Doc, you got hidden money. You need to let me come in there and work it out to people.
Wow. See?
I said, like hell you will. I refuse to. You know, maybe I'm sounding a little whatever, but Doc, I'm not with it.
I need a two-hour show, man, because listen, you know, when you get to talking and it's good, man, it's hard to stop this train. But look, you guys, I really, really, really appreciate you guys for taking these 3 weeks out with me, man. We're going to have to do this again, I'm sure, because it's so many topics, not just men, not just women, not just church, but life in general. I believe in life application, because you can hear the word, you can sing the word, you can feel it in your belly, but until you actually get it explained to you where you can understand it and actually do what the word says, we're wasting our time. And that's just what it is. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. So, man, look, I thank you guys. Thank you, thank you, thank you for spending these last 3 weeks with me. This has been epic. This has been great. This has been, I can't even think of the words I want to say, but this has been a wealth of knowledge and information and wisdom. Like I keep saying, people pay good money for this kind of info. So, again, fellas, thank you. Dr. Crawford, Dr. Reese, Pastor Ginaldo Lee, thank you guys so much for these last 3 weeks. Man, we got to do it again. Men decode it. But anyway, we got to get out of here for today. I'm Ernest J. Lee. This has been Unfiltered. I'm Annie Lee and Ernest Lee Sr.'s baby boy. And I'll holler at y'all next week. Same time, same station. All right, peace.
D. Lawrence coming at you. Get up. Come on, y'all. Let's sing this song.
Got a story to tell you.
Yeah.
Some things that I've been but here.
Yo, I'm here.
Oh, I'm here.
I like that.
Had some ups, had some downs.
Oh, you only knew.
But I'm here.
Right now I stand before you.
Oh, I'm here.
Stand here.
Oh, I'm here.
Thank you, Lord.
Had some sunshine, some rain.
Yeah.
Heartache and some pain. I'm here.
I'm here.
Oh, I'm here.
Oh, listen.
My God has touched me.
God touched me. He delivered.
He said, yeah. I'm so free.
Now my heart is mended.
My heart is mended.
Oh, I'm whole again.
I'm whole again.
You see, there's no change. My liberty, I'm healed. Yeah. Oh, say it, y'all. God touched me. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, he set my soul.
He set my soul free.
Anybody free like me? Anybody mend? Yeah, yeah, yeah. Guess what? There's liberty. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I like this part. I may have some scars.
I am here.
But I'm healed.
Circumstances.
Still got some circumstances.
I'm still here.
But I'm still healed.
Disappointment.
Yeah.
I am here.
But I'm still here.
Disappointment.
Ah, many disappointments.
I am here.
Ah, let's take it out.
Oh, I am here.
Oh.
I am here.
Ah. Say that again, yo.
I am here.
Oh. With his stripes.
With his stripes.
Yeah.
I am here.
Hallelujah. I'm here. like you mean it, say it like you mean it, say it like you mean it. That we might be healed.
I am healed.
Oh, he suffered that we might be healed.
I am healed.
From the inside out.
I am healed.
Mad love to Jonathan Nelson and Purpose. Y'all bless
you. Disappointment.
That's right.
I am healed.
Say that again.
I am